Hi everyone. Since this week we're talking about accents and stigmatization that can sometimes be associated with accents, I wanted to take an opportunity to tell you all a little bit about my story. I grew up in the South. I grew up in Texas, and a lot of people don't understand that there's a part of Texas that's very much the South. It's very interesting, actually, Interstate 35 that runs right through the Dallas-Fort Worth area, for example, is kind of a dividing line. It's interesting because it's one of the only man-made, like, linguistic or accent barriers in the world. And so linguists will actually come from different parts of the world to study that area. And I grew up in that area. I actually grew up right along I-35, but the accent that I developed was very, very southern. It was not the western accent that a lot of Texans will have. It was a very, very southern accent. In fact, when I take accent quizzes and things like that, where I get placed is Alabama. So my language, my accent was very, very deep south kind of accent. And so I grew up, it's very rural, and it didn't take me long to see that there was a lot of stigma associated with that accent. And what happened was then I began to internalize comments that people would make and became very ashamed of the way I spoke and also of myself. Interestingly, I'm a very introverted person, and that's not uncommon for people to internalize that kind of thing. I think this is very important to talk about because language discrimination does exist, and there's some research to support it. However, it's very difficult to prove. And so I think that the best thing that we can do as a society is understand that it's there and then try to work on our own biases so that we don't make others feel badly. I remember being 17 years old, and I was working in a grocery store that was right along I-35. I was a cashier, and some travelers came in, and I was speaking to them and checking their groceries, and the wife turned to the husband, and I can still remember exactly how I felt, and this very kind of, it felt very judgmental way, she said, "I guess we know we're in the South now." And I felt so embarrassed that I must have been speaking with this very thick accent. That was like the first thing that I remember where I was like, you know, I need to change the way I speak. When I went to college and decided to become a professor, I wanted to live in the north. I do not like the heat. And I became very much aware that I needed to work on my accent if I was ever going to have a chance of getting hired. So I did. I worked on it. The way I worked on it was to lose it. I still have it a little bit, and you'll hear it, and my vocabulary choices are very much Southern a lot of the times. And I'm a firm believer that y'all like should just be used universally. But I worked really hard, and it's very sad because I don't think that people should have to do that. But I did. And I studied television programs, and I started copying the way that other people would talk. And I ended up with an accent that no one seemed to be able to identify. I've had people ask me if I'm from Canada, Europe, California, you name it. I get the Canada question a lot, though, actually, so that's very interesting. I do say I'm sorry way too much. But now I miss it. I feel like there's a part of me that I've lost. And it's especially difficult when I go home to Texas because I don't fit in with my family anymore. I don't sound the way they sound. I will start to speak a little more Southern, and my husband will hear it. And you know, and it's interesting too, when I watch a film like Forrest Gump, it will come out a little more. When I'm tired, it comes out a little more. But it's not really there. In fact, almost now I almost can't even do it if I tried. And I have tried, which is interesting. But it feels like I lost a part of me, a part of my culture, and a part of who I was or am, because I had this shame associated with the way I spoke. And so that's why classes like this are so important, because we get to learn about those stigmas. And then once we become aware of our biases that we might have, then of course, that's how we do something about them. So I hope that telling my story, which I feel is really relevant to this week's study, helps someone become a little more aware of perhaps their own personal biases. We all have them, and I should say this, it's not bad to have them. What I feel like is that we just have to work on them so that we don't hurt someone else from them. And language biases are very real. So anyways, I hope you found this interesting and helpful. Thanks for listening.